Thank you, Luca, and thank you to Barilla for creating the space to discuss such a significant topic, along with the Milan Protocol and the Milan Charter, and now the Youth Manifesto. This is such an incredible opportunity and contribution that Barilla is making. You know, when you look at the television and you look at all the reports, earthquakes, droughts in California, fires, floods in Pakistan, you want to turn off the television and crawl up in a ball and think, oh, it's so overwhelming. So we look at these challenges coupled with population growth, natural resource depletion of all kinds, urbanization, and so forth, and the challenges seem so daunting, so daunting. But now I must say that I think we're living in the most exciting time of our history, and these challenges are actually the most incredible opportunities. So I think right now it's an exciting place for all of us to be, whether we're farmers like Nikiko, or whether we're policymakers, or where we're, or in the business community. We all have a responsibility for our children's future, our own future, and for our humanity. And so what I'd like to do now, well, the most important thing I'd like to say is when we're considering our decisions and all of the ideas and our discussions, which we will have later, the most important thing that we have to do is have a holistic perspective on the world. We need to consider all of our raw inputs. So when we're looking at food, we also need to consider the water input, and we need to consider the energy input. So this water, food, energy input is the most important important factor when we're looking at all of our decisions, both in the private sector and the public sector. And so, you know, there's a lot of movement happening in the world with the financing for developing mechanism meeting in Ethiopia 2 months ago, and the Sustainable Development Goals meeting in New York next week. It's such an exciting opportunity because we're seeing both the private sector and the public sector coming online to create the space for us to do these, provide some solutions. So there is a lot of movement. My only frustration has been with the Millennium Development Goals, with some of these conferences around the world, is that everybody stays in their own niche. So the food industry is here, the private sector is here, the water industry is here, and everyone's looking at their own problem individually. We need to bring these three food, energy, and water problems, issues, bring them together, and that way we can find some incredible solutions. So please keep that in mind. And the second thing I'd like to say is that leadership, it's all about leadership. There's so much money out there through the investment community. There's so many wonderful technologies, great business efficiency practices and so forth, but it's a crisis of management. So through you, we need to inspire great leaders who have creative vision, who have tenacity and verve, and understand that it's a persistent and long process. But if we all have a clear vision, imagine what we can all create. So I can speak 5 hours, but I have only a few minutes left, so I'll quickly get through some of these slides. So as you can see, the food industry is a $5 trillion industry if we also include the agribusiness. It consumes 10% of global consumer spending, 40% of global employment, and 30% of greenhouse gas emissions. So food security is one of the largest challenges of the 21st century. Now, as a food, my role in this mentoring session will be to look at it from a food industry perspective, the private sector. So look at some of these 10 top trends that a food private sector industry manager needs to consider. Globalization of our food chains. And what that means is as the world is scouring for new markets, there's a lot of changes, there's a lot of barriers for that to secure their supply chains. There's integration of supply chains, new quality standards, there's a shift in economic power. Just in 2015, Asia Pacific now has a larger middle class than Europe and America combined. So what does that do to our dietary systems? Of course, there are more empowered consumers, so through social media, they can hurt a company's reputation. There's more compliance, competitive advantage going on amongst companies in order to create more of a competitive advantage. Now, some of the business risks involved when expending some of this capital in food systems include production risk, looking at market risk, looking at price inputs and volatility, looking at climate and what's happening with disease, health, and so forth, systemic risk, what's happening on an international level, and that how that affects legal and national frameworks, looking at market distortions. Usually there's always a lag in farmers being paid and having that money rolled out on a national scale. Of course, time horizons, political risk, foreign exchange, and so forth. So see, some big challenges for an investor, for the business community. These challenges also go through all the way down to the supply chain. We have to look at efficiency models. How can, as a farmer and as a corporation, we can collaborate to share more data and to avert some of this risk? Market volatility, looking at that again and looking at new technologies, GPS systems, again, going back to the information platforms. With capital, looking at longer-term leases and new financing models now, business as usual is no longer an option. Of course, e-commerce is coming online. What does that do with changing the food system? And how does that affect local consumers and behavior? Consolidation of a lot of our companies. In the last couple years, Pepsi and Nestle have consolidated most of their businesses. And of course, packaging. Packaging, most of the 50% of a sale happens is all about packaging. So are we going to package our foods so that our foods have more absorbent pads for odors or more tagging for freshness and so forth? And of course, all the land acquisitions happening around the world is a $25 billion industry. We have investment funds, pension funds competing with governments for long distance farming. So to create an integrated food economy, you basically need efficient production, better practices, better technologies. International trade investment is very important. We have to have countries look at their trade policies, but also you have to realize that when you're importing and exporting products, it's about a month to get a product into a country because of customs. So let's create some facilities near the port in order to maintain some of that food so it's not wasted. Of course, you need well-functioning domestic markets, so averting any bottlenecks through the supply chain, having strategic reserves. For example, China and Saudi Arabia have reserves in case there's political unrest or inflation and so forth. And a very important one coming online are big data platforms. This is very exciting for me. Already we have a lot of farmers using mobile applications in developing countries to better assess their inputs. But data applications with analytical abilities that are coming online have the capacity to really change the way that we analyze future scenarios and inputs and so forth. And again, informed leaders and compassionate leadership are key. So, as I've already spoken, finally, I look forward to all of our discussions over the next couple days, but the thing I just want to impress with everybody is awareness is key. And secondly, we have an amazing opportunity right now where the private sector is coming together with big money and public sector and technology, coming together to find these big solutions to these big problems. And let's keep a holistic view of the world, and let's maintain our humanity, because somewhere along the line we've forgotten that. And it is a multi-stakeholder approach, and we have an incredible opportunity ahead of us. So thank you very much, and I look forward to the next few days.